So welcome back to Auburn City. Also this morning, Pastor Toakase Vunileva, who is here for the 2% Develop Conference that starts this afternoon at, I think, 3 o'clock. We invite you to come back. 3 o'clock tonight, there's more information, sessions that will begin tonight at 3 o'clock is registration. We'll have a session here tonight and then all day tomorrow, the Develop Conference, and then we'll end on Monday. You're more than welcome to come by and visit and join us here as we worship and celebrate. But Pastor Toakase Vunileva, graduate of PUC, went off to the seminary, married Paul, Pastor Paul Vunileva, a brother of mine. But Pastor Toakase is here with us this morning. She'll be sharing a word. And here are just a few tad things about this woman that she won't tell you. But back in 2018, she was named the North American Division, received the Principal Award as a great educator for the Adventist Church. Amen? Amen. She is also a director of the Bainham Foundation in one of their, what is it, ACE Academy. And she also sits on the board of the Develop or 2% Develop Conference. And so, Pastor Kase, we are glad that you have come to join us here this morning. And we look forward to hearing what God has to say through you. And may God bless your ministry. As we continue to worship and celebrate, thank you again for being with us. We pray that today you will be blessed.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor. Are you excited to be here this morning, church family? Come on. Put a smile on your face. Jesus is in this place. I want you to do me a big favor. We're going to take a couple minutes here. I want you to go visit somebody. Stand up with me. Go and shake someone's hand. One of our church family members, and say hi to them. Say happy Sabbath. Especially our visitors too. We want to welcome you here this morning. Sing together. It's not just us up here singing, but all of us singing together. And we as a family, we always like to hear everyone singing. So we're going to start us off. And if you won't feel like standing, stand. If you don't, it's okay. But we want to hear you sing this morning. A simple song that says, "In Christ alone."
My soul, this cornerstone, this
this morning? Amen. Amen. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. I don't know about you, but that's what we need to do every day of our life, because he deserves it. Amen. I don't know about you, but I can feel the Spirit in. Continue to sing with your heart, your mind, and your soul. And let him know that how great he is. Amen.
Splendor of the King. Good morning, church. Please be seated. Few months. I was out of state in my country, but all the time my spirit was here, because you are in my heart. So today I have three questions for you, and next Sabbath you bring me the answer. Okay? So first, what is the prayer? Second, why is it needed? And third one, what are the result of your prayer? Three questions. Please, next time, bring me your answer. Today I want to read one Bible verse. It's Exodus chapter 25 and verse 2. Speak unto the children of Israel that they bring me an offering of every man that gives in willingly with his heart, ye shall take my offering. If I bring offering from my heart willingly, God take. God see this. So it's about offering. We will have today offering, and I believe that we bring this for our hearts. Now I want to invite everybody who want to pray, please come here when we will sing, I wait for you, and we together will pray to our Father, to our God. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for your everlasting, overflowing, and merciful love. We draw near to you, Almighty God, united as brothers and sisters within your kingdom. Gather together, we lift our eyes to see your face. Expectant, this space, we lay our lives before you. May your Holy Spirit transform us. May your light shine upon us and bring peace. We open our eyes to hear your good news. We open our eyes to see your truth, and we open our hearts to receive your endless love. Fill our hearts anew with the wind of your Spirit. Jesus, no words can express our gratitude and amazement that you should die for us. How amazing is that each of our lives is so valuable to you, that you would lay yours down to reach us. Thank you for your forgiveness. Thank you for the hope you gave us. While we live in this world, we are in need. Some of our sisters and brothers are sick. They couldn't come here because of illness. We ask you to be with them where they are. Some of them are in hospital. Some are at home. Let them feel your closeness in this special Holy Sabbath day. Let their hearts rejoice. Heal them both physically and spiritually. Bless your servant who will speak today, and your word that you will be given to us. Let your word review our hearts, revive our hearts. We give ourselves in your hand, in Jesus' name, amen.
Happy Sabbath, boys and girls. Please come up for the children's story. And make sure to get all those offerings, too. Please come take a seat up here on the steps. Hi, buddy. Amen. Thank you, guys. That's great. Praise the Lord. All right. So, Who here has started school? Okay, and who hasn't started yet, but they're starting very soon? Okay, that's right, okay. Well, to go to school, you have to have some things, right? Who can name at least one thing that you need to go to school? Okay, you? A backpack. Okay, what about you? A folder. Okay, one more. Pencil box. Yes, the regular size, not the jumbo size, as we know. Okay, so we need things to get ready to go to school. And of course, there's either mommy, daddy, a grandma, grandpa, auntie, somebody that loves you got you some school stuff, right? And did you know that to go to school, your teachers also have to prepare things? They don't just come in the first day of school and turn the light on and, oh, everything's great. Nope, there's a lot of work and a lot of things that go on to have to be able to get ready to go to school. But did you know there's something that's even more important than school supplies to get ready for school? Can anybody guess what that is? Yes, God, of course. God is everywhere and God is everything, yes. But prayer. Did you know that you children, all of you, should be praying for your teachers, for your classroom, for your classmates, for the principal, for the pastors that are over your school? You guys all have so much power in your little bodies and in your minds that you can actually make your school a better place, a place that there's more fun, a safer place, all those good things. And also, you pray for your family, because it takes a lot to get up in the morning and eat your breakfast and get to school. There's a lot of work that goes on, right? Yeah, so remember that the Bible tells us in Matthew 21, verse 22, and whatever things you ask in prayer, believing, you will receive. So if you pray for your teachers and for all of your school situation, the Lord will give it to you, okay? Who would like to pray? Anybody else? You? Come. Thank you.
Dear Jesus, thank you for school. Thank you for your love. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. So make sure you say your prayers, kiddos. You can go back to your seats now.
Praise the Lord. Thank you for that wonderful message for the kids and for us older kids. Today's scripture reading comes from the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 7 to 10. And it goes like this. And lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations, a thorn in the flesh was given to me, a messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I be exalted above measure. Verse 8, concerning this thing, I pleaded with the Lord three times that it might depart from me. And he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is perfect in weakness. Therefore, most gladly, I will rather boast in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Verse 10, therefore I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in needs, in persecutions, in distresses, for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong. May God bless the reading of the word. You know, yesterday, as we were preparing for today, my daughter said, we have to do special music. I said, on top of what we're already doing, and being that we haven't sung in a long time, I was hesitant to sing a special song this morning, but you got to follow the Spirit of God. And I love this next song. We just chose it this morning, and it matches the word. It matches the word this morning. It says, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Oh my gosh. If there's something that we need to have gratitude or be grateful for, it's for who he is and what he's doing and what he's going to do. So praise God. I pray that you're blessed with this song. The words will be up here. If you feel it this morning, sing with us. Feel free to sing with us.
Thank you.
Father. We don't have much this morning. All we have is you. We know you're here already, but we ask to continue to bless us. Now bless us through the word, through your servant this morning. Bless our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Hello, check, check, check. Amen.
Amen.
I wasn't prepared for that this morning. But God works in mysterious ways, amen? I consider it a blessing to stand before you, and I want to thank Pastor Ofa and team for an invitation to share this morning. I sit in your church, and my mind went racing back to the very beginning of our ministry. This church looks just like the church we served in the middle of nowhere, in a town that had no lights and nothing else, flashing lights when we moved to a place called Gentry, Arkansas. And the church looks just like this. I sat in the seat right here where I sat for 8 years. And I knew exactly where to go because right outside that door would be the office or something else. And as I sat here thinking about the scripture that God brought, and the song that was sung, and the children's story that was shared. And I know that without a doubt in my mind that I'm here for a purpose today. Father God, we have nothing else fit for a king except to give you our hearts and just sing hallelujah to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I pray, Lord, that you would seal these lips of clay. That you would take this message. And that you would break it into as many pieces as it needs to be broken. So that anyone under the sound of my voice, Father, would hear a word from you today. Not because of your servant, but because you have a word for them today. In Jesus' name, amen. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is
great. You better tell somebody. Amen. I had to take a deep breath when Pastor Ofa texted me this week and said, hey, you're going to be at 2%. I said, yeah, you're going to be here on Sabbath. And I almost said no, that I'll be flying in at 3 o'clock. Let me tell you, brothers and sisters in Christ, it's been a long summer. I spent the very beginning of my summer here at Auburn at the Tongue and Cap meeting under the leadership of Pastor Ofa. And then it just turned into something after something after something. And if you went to Gillette, Wyoming, with your Pathfinders, that was a whole nother experience too. And then just that long summer, for some reason, Gillette just made it extra long. And so as I was trying to take a deep breath here in August, in our community, we've had several deaths. And so I've been from funeral to funeral to funeral to funeral. We buried our last funeral on Thursday, prepared myself to find my way here for 2% this Sabbath and this weekend. And I consider it a blessing to be here. And so let's just get right into the word. 2 Corinthians chapter 12. And I'm going to read it again in your hearing. And verse 7, because of these surpassingly great revelations, therefore, in order to keep me from becoming conceited, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me, but he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. For my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weakness, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weakness, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong. I've heard this text, I don't know how many times. I've read this text, I don't know how many times. But as I read it again for today, God showed up in a very different way for me as I was reading. And I'm going to come back to this slide, and you're going to help me in the back because I'm going to go straight here. When Paul starts to talk about a thorn, this is the thorn that I always think about. Thorns are what? Are they pleasant? No, they're annoying, right? They don't hurt a lot, but if you get poked by a thorn, it's like, ow, and you move on, right? But when I went to go look at what is it really saying here? What is Paul really talking about when he's talking about a thorn? And when you go back to the Greek and you look at what it says there, the root word for the word thorn actually depicts this. And when I started to read about this, I was like, what? Stakes that people are impaled on, right? That's the root of this word, thorn. In this text right here found in 2 Corinthians, Paul is talking about this type of thorn. And so then it has a totally different meaning when you're looking at it from this perspective, because no longer is it an annoying thorn, but it's a thorn that causes pain. It's a pain that you can't get rid of. It's not easily fixed by a Band-Aid that your mom can give you. When you're impaled by something like this, there's a lot of damage that is done. And when Paul is talking about the thorn in his flesh, it gives it a different kind of light. How about you this morning? What kind of thorns are you dealing with in life? What kind of things are trying to hold you back from the calling that God has placed on your life? Is it an annoying thorn? One of those things that just won't go away? Or is it causing so much pain or causing so much distraction that you can't get up and do what you're supposed to do? You can't get up and do what God has called you to do. I sat in this seat here because there are thorns that have found their way into our ministry. And we've prayed continually like Paul has prayed. Remove these things. You see, in 2018, Paul and I, my husband and I, Pastor Paul, we started our ministry in a small little town in Gentry, Arkansas. And we would find ourselves in living all over the place. I never thought that we would move so much, but we have. And we found ourselves in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, pastoring the Baton Rouge Seventh-day Adventist Church. And then we'd find ourselves in Denver, Colorado, where my husband would pastor the Aurora Seventh-day Adventist Church and then move on to the Littleton Seventh-day Adventist Church. And God would bless me with an opportunity after Ozark Adventist Academy, a boarding school in Gentry, Arkansas, to be the principal at a school called Mile High Academy in Denver, Colorado. And I'm not going to talk much about that experience except for this. God was doing something in Denver. And all the stars started to align. And God, if I could stand here, I would be preaching all day about the miracles that God manifested in Denver, Colorado. But that's not the sermon for today. But the reality is God was blessing our ministry. And some people would say that thorns come because you're doing something wrong and God needs to correct you. I want to refocus that attention to you. Sometimes when you're doing great things for God, the devil wants to stop you. And the Bible says that the devil, right, it says there that it was a messenger of Satan to torment me. In the midst of great things happening, a thorn came into our life. And it came in the form of physical health. See, my husband, when in the day when he was well, you're going to hear where this is going. He'll be up and down this aisle preaching, to the back, to the front, all over the place, preaching the word of God because he loved to preach the word of God. And every church God would take us to was a little bit broken, but God would give us a vision and that church would grow and transform and become a thriving place to be and a thriving church. And then in 2018, a thorn showed up in our life. And rapidly, my husband was diagnosed with stage 5 kidney failure. And, you know, when people get sick, and this has been my experience, maybe it's not yours. When people get sick, you pray, and then they get well. And then you move on with life. You pray like Paul prayed. We prayed for the removal of this thorn, and it wouldn't go away. And in 2018, at the height of our ministry in Denver, Colorado, this thorn started to just break things apart in my family. I couldn't work the way I needed to work as a principal. I couldn't lead the way I needed to lead as a principal. My husband couldn't pastor the way he wanted to pastor as a pastor. And this is in 2018. This is my very handsome husband, Pastor Paul. And God was using him to do great things. He was using us as a team. And I don't want to stand up here and sound like I'm boasting, but you're going to understand that at the end of the scripture where it says that my weakness, let me read that again. When I am weak, then I am strong. That's exactly what happened. Paul got sick. I had to quit my job. I didn't want to move to Southern California. I know some people think that's like the greatest land of all. But no, I didn't want to go to Southern California. I ended up, we took my family. I thought, okay, God, we're going to pray. We're going to go there for 6 months. He's going to get better. We're going to move back to Denver. We went to Southern California on our temporary move, and we prayed, and we prayed, and we prayed. And in August, I realized I'm going to have to enroll my kids in La Sierra Adventist Academy, and not at Mile High Academy, where I was the principal. August went, September went, October came, and God is knocking on my door saying, Kase, reality needs to set in. You are not going home. So in October, I called my superintendent, and I said, I need to resign. You need to find a new principal. I need to figure out Paul's health here in Southern California. So we resigned from our assignment at our church. I resigned from my principalship at Mile High Academy. And we permanently moved to Southern California. The last thing I needed to do was sell my house, and I was holding on. God said, sell the house. In January, our house sold. In February, COVID hit, and everything shut down. So praise the Lord that that happened. But as we're living life, and I'm praying, and we're asking people to pray, and God is not removing this thorn. The Bible tells us that Paul prayed how many times? Three times. And we can think about this type of prayer, right? This idea of not just three times a day, but continuously praying. Daniel prayed three times a day, but we know that Daniel was always what? He was always praying. Jesus prayed at the Garden of Gethsemane, but we know that he was always what? Paul is praying. The Bible tells us, you look at commentary after commentary after commentary. Because I was like, I read this verse, I went to the commentary, I went to the Greek. I think, why do people keep talking about prayer? What am I missing here? Paul was praying for the removal of this thorn. Let me tell you, today in 2024, I'm still praying for the removal of this thorn. It won't go away. He's not getting better. When people ask me about his health, I want to say, he's doing so well. And what I can say is this, he's stable by the grace of God. He's alive by the grace of God. And even though he cannot walk on his own anymore, he cannot see on his own anymore, this guy still wants to preach the word of God. And God has blessed him with his voice so that he continually can share what God continues to do with him, even though he's living with a thorn in his side. Yep. He said, God said, what are you preaching on this Sabbath? I said, the title is A Thorn in My Blessing. And he started to laugh. Why? Because he knew exactly what I was going to preach on. He said, you're going to preach on 2 Corinthians? I said, yes. He said, you're going to preach on chapter 12, verse 7 through 10? I said, yes. He goes, and you're going to preach about me? I said, yes. Yes, I am. And even though he cannot see the word of God anymore, let me tell you, it's a miracle to watch him listen to the word of God and then preach the word of God. What are the thorns in your life today, church? I didn't come here to preach a word. I came to tell you my story. As South Pacific Islanders, as Tongans, They are great orators of history because they didn't write them down till much later. They told a story. I just want to tell you a story today. A story of how God continues to prove to me that even though we live with this disability, God can still use that disability for his glory. And so if you're thinking today, man, I've been dealing with this thing for so long and I just want to give up, I'm here to tell you to hold on. Because your weakness is made perfect in his strength. The Bible says that his grace is sufficient. His grace is what?
Sufficient.
It's sufficient. It's enough for you. If you're getting weary of your thorn, hold on to the grace that is sufficient. If your marriage is falling apart, hold on. His grace is sufficient. If someone is sick in your family, hold on. His grace is sufficient for you. If your kids are all over the place and you don't know where they are, his grace is sufficient for them. Hold on. This scripture is not about how the thorn goes away. In fact, throughout Paul's ministry, he will deal with this thorn until he dies. But it doesn't deter him from preaching the word of God. And we're not all called to be preachers. This last week, we laid to rest a very good friend who became family, who lived the gospel. When I think about Matthew chapter 25, I think about him. Now, people who knew him may not know, like, think that about him because of maybe the way that he lived. Actions that maybe, habits that he maybe couldn't have broken, he didn't break. But the way that he lived his life was the gospel. How are you hands and feet for the Lord today? What are you doing to further the gospel today? Are you just here because it's Sabbath, and then you go back to your normal day of life, and it doesn't include serving the people that God has put in your influence? Are you daily living out the gospel? Are you letting people be loved by you, through you, not for you, but for Jesus Christ? My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. It doesn't make sense that you could be strong when you're weak, right? This idea of being weak and strong doesn't make sense to me, not in my common sense thinking. But when you think about the gospel of Jesus Christ, it makes total sense. Why? Because when I am weak, I'm not strong. When I'm weak, who is strong? Jesus is strong. And because Jesus is strong, I get to move forward in life. I get to get up every day and look at my day and think, I'm going to make it today. Not because of me, but because I serve a God who is stronger than I am. Grace. This is my husband. This is 6 months ago. And this is us at our Tongue and Cap meeting just down the street, where it doesn't matter if I tell him to stay home. He will insist on going every place. Why? Because he wants to participate in sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm going to go back to the first slide. It might be easier for you to go back to the first slide in the back there. Does anyone know what this is? Just take a guess. You've maybe seen the picture. If you have seen the picture, don't say. Someone else. Anyone know what this is? So this is a shot from space. And it's called the Okavango Delta, found in South Africa. We'll go to, and I forgot that I have this. This is the Okavango Delta. This delta starts with a drop of water in the hills of Angola and finds its way 1,800 kilometers down. And this is the largest delta in the world. And it can be seen from space when it floods. And when it floods, it feeds hundreds and thousands of wildlife. It's one of the most beautiful places I've read about, right? Because I haven't set eyes on this myself. I was watching a documentary of a group of scientists who were trying to follow this drop of water to the Okavango Delta. And they would follow the water, and then there would be places where the stream is dried up and there is no river, and they're carrying their canoes because they're trying to follow where this drop of water is going, because they're trying to figure out, how does this Okavango Delta fill up with water. And the reality is that it fills up one drop at a time. And the water comes and it gathers, and the water drops and becomes a creek and it gathers to another river. And then all of a sudden, all of these waterways find themselves to the Okavango Delta. That's how we have to practice our faith sometimes. The reality is faith just doesn't show up to feed thousands in one day. The reality is that it takes one drop, one act of faith, versus the next act of faith, to the next act of faith, so that we can spiritually, as people called to be servants of God, to be a faith that can sustain the community that's around us. What's happening here in Auburn City? Are you guys an Okavango Delta? Can the people that are found in this community find a life source here at Auburn City Church? Are you building your faith one day at a time? Are you praying for God to remove the thorns that are found in your life so that you can be salvation for those who are in this community? Auburn City is a unique place. I've learned a little bit about it as we've been coming here for our tongue and camp meeting. And I noticed, you guys, there's a this is on reservation land. When I first got here, I thought, how can you light fireworks in this place? Oh, I found out. Oh, because this is reservation. You can do anything, right, pretty much, on reservation land. Because honestly, I've been a principal at a school. There's no chance they would have let me light fireworks there. And then I've learned that there's a ministry that's right here in this community. But there's a work for each of us to do right here in Auburn City. I don't know what your challenge is today. I don't know what hardships you're working with today. I don't know what sin you might be wrestling with today. I didn't come here to condemn or judge. I did come here to say that His grace is sufficient for you. If you're struggling with something, His grace is sufficient for you. In your weakness, God will make you strong. Not because you're strong, but because He is strong. And because He wants to do something in your life. Like I said before, for some reason, God has seen fit to manifest miracles either in front of me or through me. And those miracles, I can't even explain why or how or what. But I do know this. I know this for a fact. It's because of God. It's because God is trying to use you. He's trying to use me to manifest Himself so that He can receive the glory and the honor. And through my husband's health, I've learned I'm not getting rid of this. It's not going away. I'm going to live with this until a miracle happens. And even though I pray that my husband's sight is restored, even though I pray that his limbs will work again, we have to keep working. In spite of blindness, in spite of the inability to walk, God has still called us to do work. And the work hasn't slowed down, church. It hasn't become like this small thing. No, the work just keeps expanding. And I keep saying, God, how are we going to do this? How are we going to do this new thing? How are we going to walk into it? I don't have the strength. I can't carry both of us. But you know what Jesus reminded me of? That's right. That in my weakness, He is made strong. That in our weakness, no matter what the obstacle is, no matter what the calling is, He is strong enough to carry us through. And so, church, I just came here to tell you, I just came here to encourage the one or two people that need to be reminded that in your weakness, in your struggle, His strength is yours. And His grace is sufficient. And because He lives, we can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fears are gone. Because He lives, I know that I can face tomorrow. And so that's my prayer today. That's my hope for you today as we close our worship service today. I thank you for pouring into me. My cup was empty and you filled it up. Thank you to the praise team for singing words of hope. And thank you for this church for just being who you are. And I pray that as God continues to bless you, Pastor Ofa, as he continues to bless your church, for the person who needed to hear just a word of hope today, I hope that you'll remember that God's grace is absolutely sufficient for you, and it's sufficient for me. And I'd love to tell you more stories outside or at fellowship today. Come and talk to me. I'd love to hear your stories, pray over you, and remind you that even though we're living in a life that's full of hardship and pain, God is for us. He's never against us, and he will take us. He will be with you wherever you go. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Church family, I want to invite you to all stand with us, please, as we sing our final song. Because he lives.
Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for being the reason that we can live.
Yes.
And because you live, we can face tomorrow.
Yes.
And I pray, Lord, that as we go into this week, that you would go before us, stand beside us, yes, uphold us, and shine through us so that a dying world can know that Jesus lives. Yes. And because you live, we can face the hardships of today. Because you live, they can live this life to the full. And I pray, Lord, that you would just bless the Auburn City Church and this community. May we be known as people who are hands and feet of Jesus, and that we are light bearers and hope bearers for this kingdom and for this community. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Go in peace, church family. We have lunch in the fellowship hall. God bless all of you. Have a wonderful week. Have a wonderful day.